Hello and welcome to another Out of Spec Reviews video. That right there is my Rivian R1T, and it's just surpassed 30,000 miles, and I've had it for almost exactly 1 year. And I've kept the car, the truck, pretty much stock. We haven't done all that much with it. And honestly, I wanted to keep it stock because I wanted to run it next to F-150 Lightning and Hummer EV and all of these new electric trucks that are coming out. And I think we've done a pretty good job of benchmarking a stock Rivian R1T. We've done a ton with it. I'll walk you through sort of what I've done with it so far, but of course this episode is all about what is next. And we are starting the build process for more of an adventure overlanding R1T. What's possible? You know, I'm in the Rivian forums all the time. I'm on Rivian stories all the time. And I'm seeing these guys go out, go on trails, have fun. And this truck's done more off-roading than probably almost any Rivian out there. And it's just been stock. And I have the big, you know, 22-inch wheels and tires. Now it's time to get a little bit more serious and build it into the dream. And the dream is that right there. Take a look. This is the Optima Batteries R1T. We're really using this as inspiration for our build. The guys from Optima brought this out and WiseTech Engineering to show us what's possible. And then we're gonna start doing some of these things to our truck and sort of build it into our own. Well, guys, you join me here in Huntington Beach, California at Overland Ruffrax. And my friend Sam runs Overland Ruffrax and they build Overland Ruffrax. This is Sam's truck right here. And they build these bed caps right here, these roof racks. And we are talking unbelievably high quality, next level stuff. There's this growing aftermarket scene coming out for Rivian. To be honest, it's taken a little bit longer than I would have expected for parts and accessories to come out for this truck. But Sam has sort of pioneered, if you will, the high quality, high end, hardcore products for this truck. We're not talking the cheapest stuff on the planet. We're not talking, you know, stuff that's made elsewhere. This is made in the USA, engineered here, and sort of, you know, the cream of the crop. And I thought, well, if we're gonna build our truck, let's go all out. Let's not put crap on it. And I'm not saying other stuff is or crap. I haven't really tested any of these parts yet, but I just was like, let's go hardcore. Let's go the best. So the Optima guys, WiseTech Engineering, went with Sam's rack on his truck. This is essentially the same kit that we'll be putting on our truck today. The top rack and the bed rack. Of course, we're going to be doing efficiency testing before and after and all of these things to come. But today is all about building our truck. They also have these super cool DCE rock sliders here. These are really nice because they don't actually decrease the ground clearance of the truck at all. They've put on some oversized tires on this, almost 36-inch tires. And there's an R1S in here I want to show you as well. We'll get to the wheel and tire discussion for our truck. You guys know we love Martian wheels. They're making a Rivian specific wheel that I can't, well, I've already checked out the prototype, but I can't wait to show it to you. So that will be coming soon as well. But right, well, this is spec'd very much as a street build. It doesn't have the underbody protection, doesn't have the sport wheels. And so now it's time to go a little bit more hardcore off-road. So let me at least show you very quickly what's going on here with this truck, just for some inspiration, and show you what I think I'm gonna do to mine. Well, the first thing I'm gonna do is probably, Today we're gonna put on the racks, and I wanna talk about that here in a second. But I'm also gonna put on these rock sliders. We're gonna go inside and talk to the guys from DCE about the rock sliders, why I've chosen them, and you know, not sponsored. They just were like, you wanna buy them? I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll buy them. And they're pretty cool. So then Overland Ruffrax built this top rack and the bed rack. And we're gonna go through the whole installation process today and get that kitted out. Ultimately, it's gonna be the starting point for us to then kit out what boxes do we put on it, what tent do we put on it, what shovels do we put on it. That will all come in the future. We are also going to have a custom light bar installed into our Overland Ruffrax today, and we've gone with a rigid 40-inch light bar. It's an insane light bar, and so I'm so excited to get that mounted up. And then, yeah, a lot of questions too. I'm really not sure how we're gonna wire it up, all the stuff we're gonna do. I've gone for some accessories. I've gone for the same orange grab handles around, the same sort of bronze lights, running lights, and also camp lighting around it. Sam's made some optimizations to the rack from the beginning. So enough of me talking. Let's go inside, meet the guys, and start on the build, the Overland build process of our Rivian R1T. This is a day I've been waiting for a very long time. I really wanted to give it a year with the truck stock, but now we can do everything I've been wanting to do with it. And who knows the adventures that will come once it's kitted out. I can't wait to tell you guys what we have in the works. It will be epic. You now join me inside where the WiseTech guys brought this unbelievable R1S. So I showed you their R1T outside. These were the SEMA builds for these trucks. If you're into Rivian at all, you've seen them on the forums and everything. It's really cool to see them in person and introduce you to the guy behind this whole project. This is Mike. He runs WiseTech, and dude, thanks so much for taking the time.
Yeah, no problem.
Well, I guess first, can you take us on a tour of your R1S? I know you've probably done this a million times.
Let's start at the front, and we'll work our way back.
That's awesome, because so this thing is sitting high, it looks good. Yeah, what's going on?
So we built an R1S and R1T for SEMA, and these trailers, which we can get to. It's a project that we wanted to do something different. You know, we've never done anything in the EV space, and this is a new idea.
Yeah, very cool. Come out a little closer, just because we're not using mics so they can hear us.
Okay.
But all good. So built for SEMA, but still in use now. It's not like a SEMA truck that got crushed out.
No, I daily drive this.
Oh, it's a daily.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
That's awesome, dude. And so you have, in terms of parts, I'm noticing you have some pod lights up here.
Ditch light brackets.
Yep. And so you got your own brackets for those, DCE brackets. Come and take a look at those up close. You'll see. And how does that actually mount?
So there's two bolts that hold the hood to the hinge, and that's where those bolt onto.
Very cool. And then you also have up here the Overland Ruffrax full roof.
Full roof rack with the big Baja Designs 40-inch light bar.
Things on a thick light bar.
Oh yeah. And so that's attached to the factory mounting location. We have, it's called the DCE accessory port adapter, and that's kind of a universal mounting solution to get anything either on the roof of the truck or the SUV.
And we'll show our viewers that when we install ours on the R1T, because that's a really neat piece of engineering, how that all comes through. And then noticing the rock sliders, I know we're going to get a set on our truck. Tell us about those briefly. Where did those come from? Because the other thing that's interesting is you don't lose ground clearance with that.
You don't. So it started off as anyone that has a Rivian, it kind of, you feel like you need a step.
Sure.
It's kind of, especially if it's in a higher mode. And then we decided if we're going to make a step, we're going to make a rock slider and make it really protect that door sill and the bottom section of the battery. And so that was what we set out to do. We went through probably 10 or 11 different iterations. We took down to Mexico, sliding on rocks, and came back and kept making improvements. And what you see here is the final product.
Wow. And I've seen a video of Sam and you guys all jumping on the side of the truck with no deflection.
No deflection.
It's amazing. So that is cool. Looking forward to getting that installed at some point. You also have black Rhino wheels, big ass tires. What's going on? Because these are bigger than we've seen most people run on road.
That's about a 36-inch tire. And we were kind of pushing the limits when we first built this truck to see what could we recommend? What would everyone want to run on this? This has a prototype lift kit that's not released yet.
And
we've been doing a lot of testing on that, tire wear, alignment, and things in the different drive modes. So that's something that should be in the pipeline pretty soon.
And that lift kit is a situation where you'll retain the height adjustment.
Yes.
And it'll just make each height a little bit higher.
Exactly. It shifts the entire range up.
That's cool. Hmm. That's pretty sweet. So instead of driving in low, you might drive in lowest.
Lowest would get you to low. It's not a linear ride height change, but it's similar to that.
Okay, very cool. That'll be interesting to see. And then noticing as well, you have, obviously, you have to have power up here to run your lights. We're going to be doing a similar setup on ours, similar grab handles as well. How is this, from an electronic standpoint, run?
So this is a Switch Bros. We're running the 12 switch.
Yeah, come on in and they can take a look. If you just peek through the window right here, you'll see the Switch Pros right there. Nice mounting solution as well.
Yeah, it actually worked pretty good. It's just a suction cup mount, a little carbon fiber plate on the back. So there's the main brain for the Switch Pros is mounted up here underneath the tub.
Okay, so you have the Switch Pros can under here.
Under here.
Behind the tub.
Behind it. So if you lift that tub out, it sits right in there.
Okay, very cool.
There's a low voltage connection from that to the Switch Pro switch in the cab. That's the only thing that's actually going through the cab.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a provision in the factory Rivian grommet to run that low voltage harness.
Right, okay, yep. Very cool. So no drilling required.
No drilling required. And then the wiring from that SwitchPro's brain that's going to the lighting, there's a little channel underneath from the frame rail that runs up to the route from the back.
Cool. And, you know, I guess from our side, we're getting all the mechanical bits installed on our truck. We're going to have to figure out the wiring. And I'm not sure what system we're going to do yet. I was kind of leaning towards going with Garmin or maybe seeing because they integrates with our existing Garmin stuff that we have. But we'll play it by ear. That's the next
sure.
Next video will be the electrical video.
Yep.
But then you're towing. This is the real story, I think. You're towing this sick trailer. So off-road trailer with batteries and a level 2 charger.
Level 2 charger and a kitchen and 50 gallons of water. It's a fully electric kitchen. So there's electric hot water heater, induction stove.
Very cool.
Power to run your camp, to run your Starlink, to charge your cell phone.
Yeah. Dude, sick. So I guess let's start from the battery stuff because that's what our audience is interested in. How many kilowatt hours do you have here?
55.
And that's roughly 55 usable.
Yes.
So you have, 55 kilowatt hours worth of batteries mounted pretty far forwards. How does that work out with the tongue weight on the Rivian?
It works okay because there's 55 gallons of water and the inverters are over the axle as well.
Okay.
And we can open the back up. There's a decent amount of weight back there with the spare tire and everything.
Sure.
So it's, you don't want no tongue weight, but right. It's just enough to where it doesn't kind of
no sway. So it's balanced nicely. Exactly. And the Rivians have really light tongue weight requirements. So mm-hmm. That's the main consideration. Looks like you have, what's going on here? Victron stuff.
So it's a Volta power system, control and cell setup. So this is the Volta system and it's kind of a neat way of just telling you zero to full.
Yeah, sure. So state of charge, readout, yep. And power in and out.
Exactly.
And you have 2 5-kilowatt inverters.
Yes.
So you can do 10 kilowatt charging.
Yep.
So what's that? 40 amp? 40 amp, 240
volts? This is a 48 amp
yep.
charger, but yep. We can dial it on the app.
Okay, very cool. So you can say, okay, let's turn it up or down as needed.
Yep.
And you put a wall box there. You could really hook up anything you wanted in theory.
You could. And yep. We actually have a 50 amp buddy plug that you could plug in an RV or.
Nice, like a NEMA 1450 yep. On the side. Very cool. And is this something that like our viewers who have Rivians or Lightnings or even another vehicle that just needs batteries, can they buy this from
it
you?
It is, yep.
So it's for sale.
If you go on WeissTech.com and go to the DC section, there's a lot of options.
Okay.
Some people might not want this much power, or they want more, or they
yeah.
But this is kind of what we built. It's a good compromise of having the kitchen that's usable and still having that power source.
So this is like an overlanding build. But if someone just wants it for utility to bring to a job site, they could strip all the overlanding stuff.
And that's
off.
A lot of the interest that we have. It doesn't need the off-road suspension. It doesn't need a kitchen. It can be more of a utilitarian.
So. Right. You just bring in power out to the site.
Yep.
That is pretty sweet.
And then up top, that's 1K of solar.
Okay, so you have a kilowatt solar panel, and that expands out.
That expands up, and that also lifts up, so for shade.
Oh, very cool. So
when the whole thing's deployed and set up outside, it's pretty good.
Yeah, that looks pretty freaking awesome. And can you show us how, if we open up the back here, what's going on? So you have another spare wheel and tire. Super sick. Wow, check that out. Nice drawers inside. So you got your cooktop here.
Yep, induction cooktop.
Yep. And again, these are pretty, like, you built this as like a basic, overlanding build, but a user could customize this however they needed.
Oh yeah.
And is that something you would help them with if they ordered one?
We could. And so this is based on a Turtleback trailer. So yep. There's a lot of options that already come from Turtleback that they can pick and choose.
Okay.
And so like there's a dual fuel hot water heater. So you can run a propane or electric. This is a full electric rig.
Sure.
And
sure. It's nice to reduce one more fuel to bring along.
And especially if you have solar, you can kind of sit out indefinitely and recharge and not have need a fuel source.
I mean, from my impression, it seems like, you got a lot of media with this trailer when it came out and it's like charge your Rivian wherever you go. My impression is, yeah, you're going to cut your range down with this. Yeah, you have 55 kilowatt hours. It's a little bit less than a half charge on the truck. Mm-hmm. What's really cool about this is the ability in a pinch to get some juice in your Rivian if you need, which I actually need to borrow some because mine's dead.
We'll
plug it in. So that's nice. Charge up your friend's mm-hmm. truck.
Or really, when you're out at the campsite, you can camp indefinitely with this.
Yep.
That's the magic.
And it's not, a lot of people say, oh, well, can you go forever? It's more of a range extender. It turns a one-day trip into a three-day weekend.
Sure,
it's kind of like what we like to say.
Right, and having the level two, if you're camping, it's no problem because the truck doesn't need to DC fast charge. You're hanging out and you just get a little bit to get back if you need. So yeah, absolutely love that. It's really a cool concept, actually.
Yeah.
And obviously you're from Weiss Tech. You're using a lot of Optima batteries for this stuff, at least for your main truck build, maybe like a 12 volt situation.
12 volt. There's also a 12 volt in here. There's a Victron DC to DC.
Okay.
Behind this door is the new Optima Quad 30 lithium, which is about to come out. It's designed to be a power sports battery.
Oh, cool. So nice and small.
Nice and small. So something very, you know, the size of, actually,
yeah. Oh, really small. Dang.
All like that is. It's pretty neat.
Oh my God.
And yeah. All the
literally
BMS.
Nothing. So BMS built in.
BMS built in. And one of the really neat things is this is called a power link cable. So this is made to be able to mount remotely from the battery.
Okay.
It tells you if it's charging, if it's discharging. Ooh. If there is an error like overcurrent or a short, it flashes in the sequence to let you know what that problem is.
Oh, cool.
Which is kind of nice if someone has something drawing power, it can help them troubleshoot their electrical system.
Yeah.
You can turn the battery on and off, and it has one last start Optima CPR. So if the voltage gets below a threshold, it turns off, saves that one last start.
Saves a buffer.
And yeah, it's already saved me like twice. We've been testing these things for a year and a half, so that's it works good.
Wow, that's pretty sweet. And you know, you were actually just telling me, and obviously we've seen a bunch of our viewers have 12 volt issues with Rivian. That one last start could be really nice. How do you actually activate that? Is it with this?
It's with this, and it just happened to me with this. So this was sitting in our shop for a while. The main pack voltage was low. This was earlier this week.
Yeah.
And go out to it, and I can't get the doors to open.
Oh, so it's like the whole thing's a brick.
The whole thing's a brick. And so we backfed the 7-pin trailer.
No one's going to be able to do, but that was amazing.
So we videoed it. So if anyone wants to know how to do that, if they're in that situation, they can learn from us.
So they can power it from the trailer pin.
Exactly. And then half the car turned on. It was like only the driver's side headlight, seat, doors would open. But it was enough to get the hood open. And then from there, we said, you know what, we need to have a better solution. And using the new Optima Lithium tech, we made an aluminum box that was...
So this will drop into the truck.
Yep. So this is what you have stock. It's two lead acid batteries and this bracket, the steel bracket. So we made, and this we literally just made 2 days ago. So we're in the middle of testing all this stuff.
Sure.
Aluminum with the new batteries, and this is 20 pounds lighter than this.
Before we get into your future, I mean, your other products, I really want to talk rock sliders and some other stuff. I think what's cool is, and you've been in the aftermarket space for a long time, doing performance car stuff, Euro car stuff, high quality, crazy cool things. This electric wave, we've seen some startup companies come. There's a bunch of them that started mostly around Tesla, and especially within, I'd say the last 3 years, gaining popularity, people wanting to be unique, putting every badge possible on a Model 3 type thing. What's your place in the market? What's the future of direct current engineering underneath Weiss Tech? What does this all look like? Because ultimately, our viewers are going to have a million ideas of stuff they want to see you do.
Sure.
So comment below.
We want to hear about it too. And a lot of what we've already, and there's a lot of stuff in the works too. A lot of cool things coming out soon. But a lot of this has just been necessity. I have an R1S. I experienced this. Let's make something better. And I think that's, you know, from my kids scratching my door cell, so we made a door cell protector.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's that's kind of how these new ideas are coming about. And it's exciting. It's a different area than what we're known for. And
so how hard would it be to put lockers on the four motor system?
We can look into that.
Okay. That would be cool. I think it's really needed.
Yeah.
Because I get my truck hung up all the time where I'm wide open throttle and it's just spinning the open wheels and I'm just stuck. I have to like back up and get a running start to get over an obstacle. So having lockers could use
full power. That's an idea right there.
Yeah, that's the one thing. If you could put lockers on my truck, you could like take it, have it as long as you need. We need lockers. That would be epic.
Yeah, we'll talk after.
Okay, cool. Well, so basically it sounds like you're open to some crazy stuff. You built a freaking trailer with a battery in it to charge.
Sure.
And to use. What is this? Because ultimately this is what we're going to have on our vehicle pretty soon. What consists of the rock slider kit?
So this is one rock slider. And so we designed this to be strong. We did a lot of engineering on the way that everything works. It doesn't reduce range. We've done a lot of testing. A lot of people have that question.
Yep. We'll also do more testing. So you'll get our numbers.
Yeah, more testing.
You'll get our numbers.
It does not reduce ground clearance at all. Okay. And pretty much this goes on the outer edge of the battery pack.
Right.
We designed it. You're going to do you'll probably do a video installing yours.
Yep, of course.
We designed it to be pretty easy to loosen a couple bolts and one guy in the driveway can do it and then tighten everything.
It's a one person job. Basically, just drop all the battery pack bolts on the side.
Yes.
And then you just slide this in and retighten.
And then add a couple extras.
Okay.
That gets
it
in there. And,
okay. Yep. And just super strong. These, well, when we talk to Sam from Overland Ruffrax, I really want to show you these because these are next level.
Yep.
Super cool.
And the other thing, so everything here is steel and aluminum treads on top to keep the weight down. These are black stainless hardware that if there's mud or snow on here, that gives you a little bit of extra grip.
Mm-hmm.
And then these allow you to use the factory proprietary Rivian jack points, or you can use a conventional floor jack on the bottom of the steel pad wherever you want to grab on.
So this technically is rated to handle the weight of the truck from a jacking perspective.
Yes, we've actually jacked it up right in the middle on the outside edge and lifted the entire side of the vehicle.
Wow, cool. Well, that's convenient, because using the jack points and getting the puck in there is kind of a pain.
Especially if you're AAA on the side of the road is helping you and they don't have all those.
Yeah, and very rarely do you. I mean, you have that one plastic one Rivian sends with the truck. So I keep the metal ones in there at all times.
Oh yeah, those work good too. And
then yeah.
Take a look at the bottom.
Yeah, so you just slap it
so
right
you just
on
go
here.
On one of these big, you could go anywhere, but it's ideal to go on one of the big.
Yeah, one of the big
supporting locations. Yeah.
Super cool. Well, thanks for showing us all of this. I guess, sounds like you got a lot of stuff in the works. Suspension stuff. This trailer is amazing. Can't wait to see what the future holds. We'll do videos when stuff comes out, of course. Keep our audience updated on the Rivian side of things. But I think now maybe it'd be cool. Let's talk to Sam. Talk about what we're going to do to our truck, because it's going to be next level. So, Sam.
Dude,
thanks for everything. For those of you who don't know Sam's like the rack guru. You know, I first came across your products from some of our viewers who were like, you got to get this on your truck. And I sent you a message and I'm like, we got to get this on our truck. And dude, they are next level.
Well, first off, thanks. And thanks to the viewers that like it. It's been a long time coming. When we started the company, we basically wanted to take a platform that we could serve the community far and wide. And then we've been able to shrink and contract, make bigger, make smaller. It's one of our nicest offerings because the geometry works out and it's been a lot of fun. And, you know, I get great success. The other thing, what we really wanted, we wanted the end user be completely stoked when they got it and be able to do it themselves. That was the key. Because a lot of times this community, there's not a lot of outfitters out there that can handle most of this and they're still learning as well.
Sure.
And we were learning along the path. So I took all my struggles and said, how do I make it easy, not only for a jobber, to retain their business, keep it going, keep workers going, as well as the consumer can get a wrench out and do it themselves.
And that's the most important thing too, because I'm thinking occasionally we might have to take this rack off our truck for an efficiency test or whatever might happen. And I'm like, dude, like this thing looks legit. Is it like bolted into it? And you're like, nope, you literally no drilling.
Well, actually after a service, I think Cam and Mike were taking the truck in for a service. And the service that we worked with Rivian.
Yep.
And we found out a couple things. Well, they don't like the rack on there typically. You know, they're servicing.
Sure.
There could be a warranty issue, let's say, for instance.
Yeah, if you have a glass roof issue, they don't want that giant rack on there.
Exactly. So we said, how do we make it simple? So when we do the rack, we'll drill down into that position. We actually moved what we call our antler. We moved a plate out and we made it bigger and we made access to these bolts right here. You can actually undo 8 bolts and lift the entire rack off. Set it aside, go for service, bring it back, drop it back on, lock in the key points. And again, we're going to talk a lot about these.
Yeah.
This was fun. I mean, if we could, I call this.
Yeah, sure. Give our viewers a sneak preview.
I call this the Stealth Fighter. It just got all these cool angles right here. And it's got a cap that's been honed out. It's got the logo. This hones out to go that crossbar, comes across the factory.
And this, just for those of you who may not have Rivians, the Rivian has this proprietary mounting component for roof rails and some other stuff. And it's this sort of like hook and loop situation.
Yeah.
So this slides underneath that. And we'll show you all this in a bit.
Becomes one piece. And there's a trick to it is we had to have multiple Rivians come in multiple, not one, not two, but 10, 15 vehicles come in. We found out there was some, I wouldn't say a deficiency, but an inconsistency of the casted part that's on the Rivian.
So the Rivian factory component slightly changes in size
cast depending piece. On what yeah, it's so built. Cast is cast depending yeah. on how it's sandblasted or plated. So we got this cool piece and we said, okay, let's fit in one fit. And we go to the other side of the vehicle and it was like this.
Yeah,
sure. And you couldn't hammer. So we said, let's chop off here.
Yep.
We can't expect you, the customer, to get this and have to hammer and
totally
can't do that. They want a finished good
yep.
aluminum. It's made out of 6061, I believe it is here. It's sandblasted. It's not going to corrode, but it's pretty simple. Ghost drops in here, clicks. Now it's just sitting there. There's provisions for the crossbar that's on that on the Rivian mount,
yep.
right?
Yep.
You put the base plate or whatever you're attaching to it, drop this over. And what it does is kind of clicks and stops, and now it's one piece.
Right. And it just locks that thing right in.
Yeah. I've seen some others where they're just taking like a U-bolt.
Yeah,
but the U-bolt is it can move in an event. It can sure. move. It's got nowhere to go. You want this thing to be solid, and that mass has got to fill up the gap so it has nowhere to go.
And what's cool is you're using factory points that were load rated for accessory usage, go. Not just drilled into XYZ component. This is like Rivian says, put your stuff here, so you're putting your stuff
and
there.
And the key there is no drilling, factory connection.
Yep.
OEM level type part.
Totally.
And so what you do is when you have the rack on, you're actually now taking those 4 points and you're spreading that pull rate across four. Mm-hmm. In addition to the rack actually claws on and grabs and does this.
Probably stiffer the chassis actually once you
it
put
helps.
It on.
We found an instance on some trucks where we're putting things together where the top actually becomes stronger because we bridged it.
Oh, interesting.
And it's no different than this. We've got connection points or base plates where it has a bend here, so it keeps you from bending this way.
Yeah.
Then you have that same bend is probably about 15 different bends and stop points along the way. So when you push against it, it pushes here, but pulls against itself. It's got nowhere to go.
Right.
So essentially you've taken the bed, you've extended, you've clawed it. When we put the rack on the R1T, yeah. you're going to see it kind of morph into the shape.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
it just grabs on and now becomes one
and
big
just
structure.
Locks in.
You can stand, take that entire truck
yeah.
and grab any part of the rack and I dare you see it come loose. It just won't.
That's
so, yeah.
pretty cool.
There's a lot what we call underneath the hood
yeah.
when it comes to the rack, when it comes to the connection points, how we do things. There's been a lot of time. I mean, there's a lot of 7 day weeks that we did just to get this done.
I'm sure. And why Rivian? Because there's so many different platforms out there. You have racks for Tacoma. You have racks for Silverado full size, for example.
Yeah.
What was the appeal to go into the electric space?
Yeah, we started the company based on, I had a truck. A friend came and said, put a tent on it. And I thought he was nuts. Put a tent on the truck. I got yeah. a 9-room tent, you know,
yeah,
it's got hallways. And, yeah. it's got everything you need in it. And I went out to see him. And he said, just get a rack and we'll give you a tent. We'll try it out and see how you like overlanding. So I went and looked for a rack. Couldn't find anything for a Silverado. In fact, I couldn't find anything for a full-size truck.
Interesting.
So I built something for myself and I get honks on the road. Hey, where'd you get that? Can I buy that?
Yeah.
So as I would sell these, right, I would change and make it better. And God's honest truth, I can't tell you what month or where I decided that I'm going to make this a company and I found a niche.
Yeah.
The niche was full-size trucks, and then you take it far and wide. The next step was, how do I take that platform, small business, don't have a lot of SKUs, get it to where something that's expandable and contracts, put slots so you can move in and out.
Yep.
And so as I did that, I came up with Cam, and Ken said, I've got the SEMA build. Anytime you hear SEMA build, we go, you know, I'm in.
Yeah,
I don't
sure.
care what it was.
Of course, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
If we were making batteries, I'd still try it.
Right? yeah.
But for the most part, he said, SEMA, I'm in. Rich from MagnaFlow put us together. We start talking because I work with MagnaFlow as well.
Cool.
We put a rack system on their truck and a company vehicle. And it just came about. It just morphed into this. And I said, you know what? I can take the platform. I can now squeeze it. In fact, the Rivian now is probably the strongest because the math and geometry is for the bigger trucks.
Right.
We've now shrunk it.
Yeah, so it's almost overbuilt for the Rivian.
Factory connections, 11-gauge steel, 10-gauge steel, 14, all combined. It's probably the strongest rack out there. And it was different.
Yeah,
and totally. Nobody was doing it. And well, I said, I'm in.
And, you know, I look at the other racks for Rivian, and
yeah.
to me, they kind of sit a little bit too low, and everyone's concerned about this efficiency and the aero side of things. We'll do some testing,
yeah.
but I really don't think, I mean, that's going to be everyone's question. What's the impact on range? We'll
yeah.
we'll test it, and you will also, you know, do back-to-backs, but I don't think it's going to be, you know, the roof is going to have more of an impact than the bed rack.
Yeah, I'll tell you this. So, and Josh was going to be here today. I think he had an emergency at work, but
sure,
I'm going to connect you with Josh.
Yeah.
Needed an unbiased opinion. Again, I'm a rack builder. I don't know. I always laugh. I don't know the gigawatts. So
yeah, sure.
I call them gigawatts, right?
Gigawatts. I love it.
Kilowatts versus uphill.
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
I needed somebody. He did this on his own. I needed an unbiased opinion, mm-hmm. of somebody to put it to the test. He did a 1,000-mile variant test, which meant he was uphill, downhill, traffic, no traffic, with the rack, the whole nine yards. He'll give it to you.
Yeah, yeah.
What we found is that when you put a rack, you put the tent below the cab, it's less efficient. Now everybody says, well, it's below. When the wind goes over the cab, where does it go?
Right, it's got to come down and it hits that tent.
It's the tent. So when he did his test, we raised it. We got 2-inch risers, 4-inch risers on his. It opened up now. Now you got wind that blows through.
Yep.
And then now you, and you get your whole window back.
Right. Well, that's the big thing is I like to see out what's going behind me.
Absolutely.
So I'm super thrilled with this. I mean, we'll definitely talk to him. Yeah. Maybe when we do our test and get his opinions.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll do our own. You know, we're going to put different tents on it, do a whole bunch of stuff, because it's the start of us building an overlanding electric vehicle. It's not going to be the last build. This is build number one.
Well, the other thing too is that us as a company and myself, I'm never satisfied. And
sure.
I call it, I'm putting pressure on the system. I'm putting pressure on, I say it on the industry or the segment, which means is that one cool thing about what we're doing with you today, first of its kind, I have plus nuts or riv nuts that are now on the MOLLE panels for even more connections. And this is the thing that opens it up for more things. And again, I want to put pressure on myself every single day that I'm out here, 7 days a week, guys. I'm crazy. I do. I work 7 days a week.
I know. I can call you any day and you're like, oh, I'm at the shop.
and this is what we do. And I'm putting pressure, not only myself, but to build what I can do to come up with new things that can help everybody out there, whether from, if it's rotopacks for water on an EV, right? Shelves that drop off the MOLLE panel as an accessory. You can put air conditioners on there because
there
are these portable air conditioners, water tanks on there. And I want to put enough pressure on myself to continue to build the company and make it cool. Answer the question as to why it's different. One of our company mottos, we've got two that I'm really deciding on, is dare to be different.
Okay, like
or
it.
Or dare to take a risk.
I like it.
We took a big risk on this. We got, it's a cross-platform deal. Everything from roof rack to the bed rack, it works. We're excited about it and thoroughly excited to have our viewers mention us and have you out here as well.
Yeah, I'm pumped as well. And, you know, it'll be on our truck a bunch and I'm sure people will check it out and see it and, you know, come up with ideas too. So if there's stuff you want to see, again, everyone here at least is open to collaboration. Leave comments below with cool stuff. I mean, ultimately, the way I look at this, today is the day we put on the base for our truck. And that's the most important part for us because it's going to be on the truck for years and years. We're going to put a whole bunch of accessories on it.
Right.
It needs to be solid. It needs to not squeak. Like, it's got to be super pro.
Well, I'll tell you this much. First off, USA made, big deal for us. My truck is 100%, our offer is 100% USA made.
Great, yeah.
Everything now, to the lights, to the exhaust system, my sponsors, all American made. We just signed with Pelican now. We're going to be used to work with Pelican. We've got just a bunch of cool stuff here. We wanted this thing to be, again, efficient. We wanted it to be cool. We wanted it to grow. And again, in order to do that, you got to have a USA-based custom because we can make the buck stops here. It starts and stops right here.
Totally.
On the board, right?
Yeah, that's right. Your whiteboard over there.
And that board is where we start the ideas, and we can make the choice whether to work or not, whether we're going to do it or not.
It was funny. Sam was like, he was like, oh, I got this idea. I'm going to do all this. I'm like, is this the whiteboard that like every idea starts from? And you're like, yes, the whole company runs on this whiteboard.
I've come here in the dead of night and figured something out and could not sleep, and it's 2 a.m. I show up here.
Yeah.
Pencil out. I start pulling stuff together. I start cutting. We have a fabrication area over here.
Nice.
And I just, it comes out.
It's amazing.
You know? And the last thing I'll say is it's a big thank you, because the challenge that I have as a small business and a growing USA business, there's a lot of things that we have to do on a day-to-day basis, one of which is this marketing.
Totally. Yeah.
What's under the hood is the segment that I've been trying to put out for probably 3 months. And what's under the hood means when you put that rack on, there's a lot of stuff, 3D scanning of roofs, brackets, compound bends will show you to get airflow, all this cool stuff that nobody knows about because they go, well, it's just a rack. It's more than just a rack. This is the first time that we've had soup to nuts explanation to your users because that's what they're looking for. And I will say the users are a lot more savvy and technical because they like the details, right?
I told you, we have the nerd audience.
And this is our platform to do that. This will answer all the questions as to why, how we got here, why are price points where it's at,
right?
What it could mean for the future of the vehicle as well, what we're doing to go forward, accessories, what have you, acceptance of ideas. This is the first. We're super happy and thankful that you're here to help us with that.
Thank you. I'm thrilled as well. And, you know, we just want to build, the whole point of us doing this and reaching out to you was basically for those reasons. I want to know who's innovative, who's going to be around for the electric revolution, because the Rivian's not going to be the only electric platform that you have. So we are trying to find, you know, the right companies to talk to. WiseTech, of course, going crazy on the Rivian platform, finding the guys, you know, Martian Wheels, creating this sort of, I would say, online showcase of what we think could make a pretty cool electric overlanding vehicle. And also on the same time, we're doing our Model S Plaid and going crazy on the performance side for track stuff. And we have to do suspension, and that car needs a lot of optimization. So, you know, our core business is reviewing new cars.
Yeah.
But this is where my passion is.
Well, I tell you, it's you mentioned something, and collaboration is the key. So working with WiseTech and DCE, you take a race platform in WiseTech, great minds, thinking, I mean, I see the superchargers that they build. It's insane, right? 3D modeling stuff for testing, getting it working, and then taking that concept to production. So you got a race mind with technology, all this latest and greatest sophistication to get there. And then you've got DCE, you put, marry the two together, you got race technology and ideas. This EV side stuff is a lot easier than what they're doing. So you've got, you've got smart guys making these cool things for overlanding. So when I met with them, we clicked instantly because we get it. We think alike, build strong, build fast. And if it's supposed to take a quarter 20, I put a 3/8 in there. I want it strong.
That's right.
Beat the crap out of our stuff.
Yeah.
You might have mentioned in this video, you know, earlier, just beat the crap out of the rock sliders are meant for that.
Yep.
Our racks are built that way as well. So you've got all this technology, and it's fun to work with other people, okay, that are like-minded, that have the capability and the horsepower to get where we need to get to. They've got it. We put it together. We came up with the SEMA builds. That was 2 weeks.
2 weeks he did that.
2 weeks.
Holy
and
crap.
That's like a lifetime in SEMA bills.
Amazing.
Right? So it wouldn't happen without the partnerships that we gained. I mean, Black Rhino made those wheels in 2 weeks.
Right. Yeah. That's amazing.
We made spacers for the offset in 7 hours. 7 hours. So to have the horsepower with that race and relationships, build the collaboration, far none. This business, I had Goose Gear here yesterday.
Yeah.
And MagnaFlow was here. It was a chance meeting. We're all just talking about things.
Yeah.
And he's literally over the wall. You were at Goose Gear earlier.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
We talked about the fairness and the willing to talk to each other in this field, in the overlanding community, and sharing ideas is tremendous. It's even better than the race because there's people sharing and their ideas and talking about what they're doing.
It's not so much a competition. It's how can you go out and have more fun?
Yeah, you'll find that there's some competition and you got those guys that naturally want to do this. Those are the bigger companies. It's built up a bunch of small, medium-sized businesses that are car enthusiasts that love motors, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's EV or gas.
Yep.
And they like sharing their ideas, and it's fun to have that conversation. You know, we call them campfires and conversations about your build. So it's been super excited. I'm excited. So thank you.
Like I said, it's from our side. It's not going to be the last time you're on our channel.
Thank you.
It's day one. It's let's partner up. Let's find all the right pieces of the puzzle. Let's get our truck out there. I want to test it too. Because if it's bad, I got to tell you, like, hey, you got to fix something. Not expecting it to be. You've already done that with these trucks being beaten up as well. And should we get our truck in and kind of talk about how this is all going to go and, you know, talk about how it's going to get put together?
Well, I'm going to put you on the spot for something.
Okay.
I want a rack with surfboards on that Volkswagen.
Oh, on the ID Buzz? Hell yeah.
I think that's going to look insane. It'll look good.
I called my dealer for the ID Buzz and I said, I want the first one.
Yes.
And so I'm first on the list. Awesome. So it'll come straight here.
Let's make it happen. Appreciate it.
ID Buzz rack, next project. Let's get our truck in.
Thanks. So now what we're going to do is Alyssa's going to move our truck out of the way. We're going to pull the WiseTech R1S out and actually get it plugged into our truck just because we're at, I don't know, sorry about that. So we're about, 8% state of charge on our truck, something like that. So we'll get a little bit of juice while we chat for the next shot. And just want to show you kind of how this whole thing works. I just love that you can literally go and just buy this trailer and kit it out. You know, you could choose not to put a solar panel on the top. You could put another tent, so you could have a rooftop tent on your truck and your trailer. That's probably how I would do it. I'm not sure the solar panel would really help that much with only a kilowatt or so. Maybe you could get 2 kilowatts in there if you get a big enough panel. Not sure it's needed with such big batteries, so maybe a double rooftop tent could be pretty sick. Loving the turtleback trailer. This is cool. We got to do some tow testing. We're going to be doing off-road trailer testing too with our Rivian. So many tests to do. We're spinning back up the out-of-spec overlanding channel after this as well with our truck. So get subscribed over to that channel because we got a lot of stuff like this that we're going to be starting to cover. And if anyone wants to film for that channel, if you're an overlanding enthusiast who understands electrics, send us an email. It's in our description. We need to find someone around. Zach, of course, will be filming for that channel still, but he's got a full-time gig and not always around to cover stuff. So looking for one other person to work for us for that overlanding channel. Check this thing out. Oh, dang. That is such a good-looking rig. You know, I'm really going to go and make my truck sort of my own. Let's hope he doesn't fall off the rails here. And he might. All right, let's hope he comes down. And down it comes. Such a cool looking rig right here. We're gonna get the trailer plugged into our truck. Man, this thing is freaking beefy. They got their WiseTech manufacturer plate on there. Love to see that. We're gonna pull the R1T in really quick and just talk about what we're gonna do to our truck, because I'm sure some of you don't wanna stick around for the exact build. Maybe if some of you are thinking about going for this product, you definitely should stick around. I'm so curious to see how the installation process works, because ultimately we want you to watch this video and not have to go to a shop to get it installed. We want you to be able to do this right at home. And man, these two trucks are just next level epic, aren't they? Can't wait to see them out on the trail. We'll have to go overlanding with these guys sometime and do a little out of spec slash WiseTech trip. I don't know where do you want to go on a trip? We got to do some overlanding adventure.
Yeah, I think we might do Moab later this year. That might be
anytime you're in Moab, we're nearby. Let us know. We'll do some crawling with the trailer. That'll be interesting to see. So yeah, let's get our truck hooked up and see this thing charging. We are at 7% state of charge. So let's see how this trailer hooks up and works, because I'm really curious, how do you even turn on the trailer? Can you turn it? Is it always on? How does that work?
So it actually runs, I'll show you this. There's a Volta control system which turns on the DC side of things.
Okay.
It feeds the Victron inverters, which is generating the AC. And there's a sub panel in there that has multiple breakers that feed 120 and 220.
Okay. So both inverters will get you 240 volts.
Yep. And it's fired up right now.
Okay. It's great. Well, let's do this. They got the wall box level 2 on there. One of our favorite units. We love this thing. That's the Pulsar Plus, right?
That is.
Yep. Very neat. And so I'm okay to just plug it in?
Just plug it in.
Okay. So here we go. Here's the handle. This just comes out and in we go slightly. Boom, locked in. We'll wait for the port to go. Let's see what it says inside the truck. This is wild. We are literally charging from a trailer. Now, of course, there's a whole bunch of other trailer products. Charging, sick. We're at 1 kilowatt now, ramping. Love to see that. Yeah, I had the truck in conserve mode. I was rushing to get here this morning, so I didn't charge on the way. 5 kilowatts at the moment, 6. Love to see that. 8 kilowatts. 9 kilowatts. 9 kilowatts. Sweet. Well, there we go. Getting like a pretty solid 8 or 9 kilowatts right there, right from the trailer. That's pretty freaking epic. Let's run around and just take a look and see if we hear any noises or anything. I really love, these are an accessory, by the way, to the racks. We are going to be putting these lights all around our build, all the way down the bed, and also these sick grab handles. So yeah, lots of stuff. You guys let us know what you want us to do with this truck. Alyssa, we're like open to ideas, right?
Anything and everything.
Yeah, we're gonna
need some stuff to, we need help with the dog side of things, definitely though.
Yeah, the dog side of things could be interesting. One of our friends is actually working on maybe a camp kitchen recreation, if you will. If we look over here on the trailer, look at that. 9.5 kilowatts output. It says it's got 2.8 hours of time left to do this. Again, it's really nice in a pinch to level 2 charge something. This is really awesome, but I love the idea of using the batteries around at a campsite as well, just having mobile storage. Why not? Everything is silent. The inverters have a slight fan noise going. Yeah, I hope one of you guys buys this trailer and like lets me know what you think about using it, because you know, certainly not going to be cheap, but it's really freaking cool. Nothing we're doing here today is inexpensive. This is not low grade products at all. This is all sort of next level, super well put together stuff. But we are literally, you know, you could be out in the middle of nowhere, and we're charging essentially off of solar if you charge it up from the giant solar panel on top. Pretty sick. All right, guys, welcome to part two of this video. Hell yeah. This is not nearly as nicely produced as the first part. Not that anything we do is nicely produced.
You get what you get.
You're not paying to watch this video. No. We are going to start the build process on our R1T. And I thought maybe we'd do a separate video, but really, again, this is getting our truck, the bare bones of it, ready so that we can do cool stuff later too.
And then we're gonna spend so much money on all the different accessories.
Well, we have a lot of stuff we're gonna buy for this thing, and you know, certainly just, you know, we're just going along for the ride. We want to see how we're going to use the truck, build it for our needs. We want to see what you guys are doing with yours. And so basically the truck is aired out in conserve mode to lowest, so I've dropped the suspension all the way so that it's easier to get to these top mounts for the roof rack. I'm going to be really curious to see how the noise is on the highway with the light bar and everything. We have basically, these were the hooks I was telling you about where they designed that mount. That's basically, everything's going to be locked to these. We're also planning to put a rooftop tent on top of our bed rack, which will come separate video, because I want to test a few tents. I didn't want to just like go online and buy an iCamper 3.0, which seems to be the right tent.
The one and only. It's
That's what everyone's running.
But it can't be the one and only.
I mean, I thought let's try out some different ones. So maybe we'll go, you know, there's like Colorado 4x4, there's Sparks Overland. I want to go see what those guys have before we totally lock in everything. But essentially this can all be removed. So I say it's the last time the truck will be stocked, but we're not drilling anything.
No.
So it can all be removed.
Thank goodness, because we're not good at that.
You know, we're bad at trailing. That's why Sam's guys are going to help us with this, but we're not doing anything like that. Sam, can you show us how that mount locks into...
I'm getting the speed going here, because this is one of those builds where...
Full set.
We call this the aerodynamics, or the Lamborghini, or the... like, what's the Stealth Fighter?
Yeah,
just sure. Check this thing out. Look at the angles. There's a lot of detail in this thing. Look at all the angles that you have to make this thing up.
So do you have a 3D model of this that you guys produce? Is that how that works?
Yeah. And so it goes into SolidWorks. Mm-hmm. First you scan this. We had to scan this here.
Okay, yeah.
Scan distance, depth, width, everything in here. So you got a probe, you're scanning.
And this is the same as R1S mounts. The R1S has three on the roof.
Yes.
And this has four
slight
in total.
Variation on the roof, slight. And then we spoke about earlier, there's some inconsistencies due to the nature of how it's made. It's not a bad thing, it's just inherent of casting. And then when you cast something and you sandblast or treat it, your tolerance tends to move a little bit. And
totally.
It's a piece that's not a high tolerance product, right, at first, because everything is universal.
Yep.
We wanted to make something that filled in the gap. And we had several vehicles that we had to test to make this fit, to come up with a happy medium of what those tolerances need to be. Because once it takes all those little angles and cutouts, it slides in together like this. It becomes one with now your bed. Mm. And that's the biggest difference, because I saw there's a couple of guys out there now that just have a U-bolt in there.
Okay, interesting. But that leaves room for shifting and rattling.
Shifting, rattling, and also a pull point that is just too much pressure on one point of that pull point. Mm. You need to make this part of it. So when you drop this thing in here, well, you have first generation, don't you?
Yep, my truck's an early one.
Yep, so you can tell this is pre, there you go.
Yep.
That's so satisfying.
Yeah, that's so cool.
It is, and oddly enough, with the word satisfying comes out good, because when you see this rack kind of morph together, right, it is amazing, because it actually starts grabbing and shifting into place and morphs into like a transformer. But a close-up of that, this now becomes one with that. This is honed out here. Base plate comes over, drops over, serves as a big washer.
I mean, you could really just sell this.
We do.
Oh, you do? Separately. We do. Okay.
For other things. We're starting to do that now, so we had to make it, again, more reasonable. I think we got the best that we can. The trouble with this here is it takes over 40 minutes, well over 40 minutes to make all these pieces.
Right. And they're super cool. And so this is in partnership with DCE.
Yes, it is.
Yep. Very nice.
Yes, it is. Five-axis machine mill to make that. You can't just put this in, you know, sand and all that
right,
stuff.
Right, yeah.
It's a precision piece that becomes OEM level attachment, because super important to have from just a reliability standpoint. We want to make sure that this connects correctly, holds on secure, no shifting, fills the gap.
Yep.
That's the difference between a U-bolt with some threads on it. I would not ever sell anything like that because it doesn't meet the quality and the experience that we want for the customer. The
sure.
Rivian buyer wants to see technology. There you have it. So we're going to walk through, and that's the basis of the rack, is when you put these pieces in here. Again, you've got Gen 1.
I know, it's kind of fun to watch you try to get it. Once it's in, you're good.
Yeah. And then we're just going to walk around, and here's how you get them as a kit. And this is universal to all of them. And this has a little, just tight in there. But see the little space in between there?
Yeah. Yeah.
When we do the roof rack, that spacer goes in, this locks down, and the roof rack attaches to the top of this one.
Mm.
This fills the gap to get over the little bit of the body mold that's
sure.
in there right there. So
okay, that's cool.
It. So we'll start with that, and we'll do the base plates here real quick.
So also, just back here, I just want to show our viewers, this is the rack. This is the whole bed system laid out. So what are all these pieces? What is universal? What's specific to Rivian?
Okay, the Rivian is unique in itself is that because it's smaller, we took the geometry from our full-size truck and we squeezed it down. So on our full-size line, everything's cross-compatible. We can cross-pollinate things. On the Rivian, everything's specific due to size.
Oh, right? Interesting. Okay, yeah. So pretty much everything had to be kind of re-engineered.
Everything. And mind you, we had 2 weeks from the start of SEMA.
But can you use the Rivian size same as Tacoma or Gladiator?
No.
So it's all specific.
Are different. Angles are slightly different. All shrunk down because the size of the bed dictates the width of the MOLLE panel.
But that's a really big, that's a huge spine. Leap of faith because back then, I mean, when you did this stuff, no one knew if Rivian owners were going to be into modifications. Yeah, exactly. You know, yeah,
dare to be different. And like I said, the buck stops here. We decided to jump in big with it because, again, it's a shared space. There's enough room for everybody to play. The amount of vehicles compared to, let's say, a Silverado out there, yeah, it's smaller, but it's growing.
Yeah.
And it's ever every week we see more and more come out. So we have to either take care of the space or get rid of it. We chose to jump into it because, again, there's enough to go around.
And I think it's a great starting point for you guys to really establish not only the Rivian brand, but other electric
trucks. I'm
going to
back
trucks.
Up something. I got to backtrack on something. I just thought about this.
Sure.
This actually, this right here, we call this our antler.
Yeah.
I'll show you why. We're just talking one day. I'm talking to my engineer. We have a love language.
Yeah.
And I say, you know that thing we made? It looks like an antler.
Yes.
There you have it. There's our antlers, right? And I laugh every time I do that. That's actually the first time I did that on camera, you know, like a
well there, that's going to be your new that's contact it, photo in my there phone
is. There it is. This is cross compatible with our 1500 or 2500 series. It's the height, our antler. We
yep.
have a general height that we like to put on the rack, so this is cross compatible. Everything else,
so then all of this is Rivian yeah. specific.
So that's the okay antler. We now have, take a look at this. We now, I had a logo problem. I was printing UV ink on high grade plastic or PVC.
Yeah.
And the ink was coming off from the sun. So now we silk screen on aluminum, black pop rivet on every one of our these here. So they last. So
that's cool.
Made in USA branding, right?
Yep.
Cutouts, bottle.
We need like an out of spec edition.
Yeah, there you go. With silk screen, we could probably do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, okay,
right?
Cool.
And now I'm happy. This is awesome. This is my favorite thing.
Yeah, you called me so excited about this yesterday.
And I like going bigger, going home. Like they say, I'm a little bougie at times.
Yeah, hell yeah. Right? Well, you're doing Rivian racks. Of course, right. We're bougie.
First time, Riv nuts for rotopacks, either straight up or sideways, right?
So sick.
3/8-inch bolts here. If you're doing a power tank, you want to mount the bracket on that holds the power tank. You want strength. This avoids you having to have a through nut bolt on there as well and get behind there. You can screw right into it with a little bit of Loctite. We've tested them. I put them on with a pneumatic machine and look at the consistency.
Yeah, wow.
That's
check
what you
that
want.
Out. So this was all done by hand, of course.
Well, with the pneumatic machine.
Right.
It has to be done that way. You
okay.
can't. You have to grab each one of them and put them on there.
But that's a pretty lengthy process.
Actually.
How long did it take you?
Honest?
Yeah.
I want to time myself for a time study to see how we're going to price this thing. It literally took me to do 8 rib nuts. It takes me a little under 3 minutes.
Okay, so maybe $30.
Well, that time yeah. equates to that. That's
yeah,
what we're trying
sure.
to figure out right now.
Yeah,
is
right.
that what it equates to put them on all 4 MOLLE panels.
Right.
And then the inside MOLLE panels, which we'll be putting on there, I put quarter 20s because you'll be putting smaller things on there.
Okay.
Heavier things you can use the 3/8 bolts for. On the inside, you're hanging shovels and small
yeah.
bags. So if you don't find a through hole, you can find a quarter 20 and find the pattern.
So
and
nice.
You should not have to drill any holes because when you drill into this, it's steel.
it'll rust.
Right, and you really need to avoid the rust situation. So that's why more options to mount, the better.
You know, from a technical standpoint, here's the wrench pockets we're talking about. You put a wrench in here, you can untighten this while it's on the rack, take some weight out, but also you can get two wrenches in there to take it on and off, outfit, put it back on, wrench pocket it back in, and you're good to go.
That's so cool.
Another thing about our powder coat, we spend three times the amount that everybody spends. There's something called BK08. It's very standard in our industry. Just a black kind of satin. This is textured, has a little bit of oyster and has metal crushings in here. It's made by Prismatic in Oregon.
Hmm.
Three times the cost, but wow. It just
deep looks black. Amazing.
It just, and wait, what we're going to do when we leave, I've already done it to the antlers. We put a ceramic coating on there and it just blackens the black.
Yeah.
It looks really rich, stays that way. It also cleans really easy.
Yeah, good, right? For water beading.
Absolutely. So,
yeah, and we got to get you hooked up with Colton, our guy on the detailing channel, to talk about ceramic coatings. That could be fun sometime.
Hey, we're going to be putting on this here in a second here. This here is the base. And what we've done here is we have provisioned a special cutout right here. So that slides, our piece slides in there, and we could take the rack on and off. This is just specifically for the Rivian, for that connection point.
Oh, very cool.
The antler fell in place where that connection was, so we had to make provisions for that. And then we have another connection point here. And then this here is for the hatch, that, you know, the storage hatch.
Yeah, yeah. So how much does the whole system weigh?
Probably a little less than 100 pounds.
It's really not bad.
No. So we put the strength here where we need to on 10-gauge steel.
Yep.
Put a bend here. So this doesn't want to bend forward here.
Sure, right?
So
sure.
This gives you strength here. And when this all ties together, once you see the angles, it'll make sense. So now, this one here, okay, let's actually pull that off real quick. Let's pull this off real quick here. Let's take this one off here.
There's Alyssa building our Rivian.
Well, we wanted to know who was correct with where the washers go.
Yeah, it was a competition. Well, you both lost.
Okay, great.
Okay, so... If you're on the roof rack, it'd been a little different.
Okay, nice.
So there we have our bases in here.
Right, so we showed that. So you got bases, okay, front and rear.
So let's take this, hold that for me real quick.
Can do.
There we go.
Uh-oh, losing a part.
We won't need that.
Okay, great.
Okay. Slide this over, take a look here. Look where that
Do you want the washers on this one?
No, okay. Don't even need them.
Well, they're on there.
Oh, thank you.
Yep.
There we go.
Okay. That's
look,
sick.
Look where it lines up, right? Okay, so now.
And so I leave, so my door still opens. Totally pro, perfectly cut out for that. Dang, so no loss of functionality here. That's sick.
Yep. So the other thing, now the question for you, are you gonna take this off anytime soon or anything right now?
No.
Okay, cool, so.
Because when I do the efficiency testing, I'll just choose another truck with the same wheels. And I was asking you too, while you're doing this, how many racks, I mean, not an exact number, but do you think you're going to have enough to keep up with so many Rivian owners wanting to outfit their trucks?
We will. So what's good about this is because we settled in on certain manufacturing processes, I can take my build, I could send it to multiple manufacturers, which I'm not going to do, but I can take it from low scale, medium scale to a high scale facility. We have everything catalog, part number skewed, mm-hmm. and be up and running in less than a week.
Oh, no way. You know, amazing.
It's that simple,
okay.
Because everything is cross-compatible with the machines yeah. that we use and what have you.
That's so cool.
Now, this is the cool part. So check that out. So I got my blue Loctite on there.
Yes, it's right under there.
Right underneath there. We've taken on the antler. We've extended out the base. We're not going to tighten it just yet. Once we put this in here and line this up in there, see it kind of click into place.
So do you think you'll make just base accessory plates for the Rivian separate from the bed rack? Is there a need?
Yeah, there is. We're starting to see it now. So we'll sell these different for different applications. As long as they have the washer system when they're using, it's important. If you don't have this base plate, that you use these here, because that gets it lifted up enough so you don't put tension on that bar and break it if you're tightening it down.
I see. Right? Okay. And so, also the tonneau should, I mean, the tonneaus don't work from the factory anyway, right. but mine does. And so it's not affecting the tonneau at all.
None whatsoever. It's all right here. And then what's cool about this here is once this is tightened down again.
No washers, Tim?
No washers. Yeah. And then this one dot, not a lot, right? So I've hand tightened this. I'll grab that and pull that.
Okay. So this is all just hand tight. Whoa.
Not
Dang.
Even tightened. So I can undo this. Look at, I'm undoing this.
Yeah.
Super important to see this. I'm undoing
this. So even
this.
If they back themselves out somehow.
Okay, look how loose this is, right?
Yeah, totally.
I'm gonna do this with my fingers. Wait till it gets tension right there. Just enough to where it gets tension right there.
Yep.
This one here, tighten it down with my finger. And guys, you don't have to crank these things down right there. Now do it.
Dude, locked in.
That's the difference between a U-bolt that has some threads on it.
Yeah, because even if I'm just like banging into this thing, it is freaking...
And that's the foundation of the rest.
But these, I think, are almost cooler than the rest of the system because there's so many different uses for people to have this type of side plate. So OverlandRuffRax.com, one day soon.
Yeah.
Keep an eye out.
R-U-F-F-R-A-X.
Yep.
It's spelled the wrong way, they say, but no, it's spelled the right way.
It'll be in the description.
Okay. These are the front.
Okay, what told you it was the front? How'd you know that? Okay.
Good question. You've done this before.
I don't know.
So this flat part here is to the front. I don't want any whistling or any noise.
Right? Sure.
So that's flat, right? Our Gladiator is the only one that we have a face plate where we have holes on it because we have a cross window molly panel.
Okay.
And a cross bed molly panel where we utilize these holes. So from a wind and efficiency standpoint, every little bit counts. You slide this over like that, right?
Whoa, that's easy.
And that's just it, okay? And then, so what we have to do to save ourselves a lot of trouble, but I'm just going to put these on to show you what we do, and we'll get through this really quick.
I feel like we're on a cooking show. You have everything out.
You know.
Yeah, it's like QVC.
What indicates this being in the center? It's going to be made in USA for one, right? But molly panels connect to both sides.
Oh, nice. Yeah, so that's we got holes on both.
Yep.
How about that? So you have a specific front.
Yep. And the back, here's
so when you drive backwards real fast, it'll be quiet.
So because we did this extension, if you look at the, look at that piece here, that stem, and look at this stem, what's the difference?
Yeah, no, totally different.
Right?
Yep.
Okay, so this is gonna answer your question, two parts to the answer, and we'll show you later. When this slides over, we move that plate forward so you can get a wrench in here to untighten that nut, that bolt. And this one here, slide this out, lift the rack up if you go for service.
Right, that's cool.
The only reason why that exists right there.
That is really, really cool. Yep.
So for those of you that take the Brave stance, you want to put lights on. And I say Brave because not a lot of people want to touch the 12 volt. Don't be afraid of it, guys. It's not hard.
I'm going all in, all the lights. You asked, do you want lights? I said, I want every single light you got.
So before you put the antlers on, right? Put on the lights. It's hard to access the nuts and bolts.
Okay.
Let's grab all the small boxes on the end over there.
So what are the lights that we're installing? Obviously, you're not making the lights, right?
No, that's my only buyout right now that I buy out other than the WiseTech stuff.
Yeah. And WiseTech, I mean, you guys have a great partnership that we saw earlier. They're super cool. And I've known them from the performance car space as just being second to none. Yeah. Oh, what the heck? That's so cool. So it is your component.
Yeah. But what I'm doing is I've just joined up this year with Rigid Lighting. This is the only overseas component that I have because nobody has at what we call reasonable price rack lights.
Yeah.
Because on the rack, you have 8 in the front on the roof rack and you have 6 here.
Right.
At $89 a pop, you're paying more for lights than you pay for the whole rack.
Sure.
I can't do that.
Sure.
So I'm offering this, but I'm also going to be offering... I am going to put slots in there so you can put either Baja Designs, a Rigid Light, Heretic Studios, or our light in there, and then you can make your choice.
And we haven't told our audience yet, but can I show them the light bar really quick?
Oh, sure.
Because I wanted a sick-ass light bar, and you were like, I know the light bar you need, and it's this. This is, first of all, speaking of not cheap, this is not cheap.
Yeah.
This is a Rigid...
this is Rigid Industries eAdapt technology. The cool thing about this, it's got battery efficiency technology in addition to adaptive through GPS, which means it's going to adapt to the conditions of your driving.
Which is cool. So it actually changed the beam output based off of the speed that we're driving.
Yes.
I cannot wait to run this at night.
So... It's actually pretty tremendous.
And it's off-road use only, technically, right? I think, allegedly. I'll never run that on the street if anyone from DOT is watching. Yeah, so there's different speed ranges. So it looks like from 0 to 10, 10 to 25. And what I heard about is there's a few light bars that do change based off of speed.
Right.
But this has this really smooth transition where it brings in. Have you tried it yet?
It's finite. So I have the old version. The difference between this houses this. Hooks into the standard housing that they have now.
Okay.
I have the old eAdapt because I like the dome light. I like the backlighting.
Yeah.
Downside is there's another harness that you have to put with a controller. This new one has all the technology
all in
built
one.
Into two connections. So the harness itself is really, this looks scary, but it's not. It's a single source connection. That's the harness that comes with it.
Okay.
Your on and off switch. There's all the stuff that fell out.
Great. Yeah.
But it's a single connection, three wires you're in. With the other one, you have to have a separate controller that you run to your dashboard to help with some of the technology and turn it on and off. This has it built into a standard housing, kind of a condensed version. And
nice.
The biggest thing is the battery efficiency technology. Rigid, I'm hoping I'm getting that right. We could follow up with them and get you
all
the data.
Yeah, well, we are going to do probably on my personal channel. It'll just be called Kyle Connor. Yeah. I'm going to do a whole light bar test. I'm going to take it out and I'm going to call the Rigid guys and talk to one of their engineers before doing that. Because as a consumer, you know, I bought the light bar. I wanted to know off of your suggestion. Thank you. And I was like, how does this actually work? And I couldn't find any good videos out there about it.
This one's new.
Okay, so that could be why.
Well, the race guys use this. This is really the guys that do all the pre-running and desert racing because they're doing 80 and all of a sudden they're doing 5 miles an hour.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, let's show everyone the grab handles. And soon, you just made the announcement, soon to come in Rivian Compass Yellow.
Yeah, so maybe you could help me if you can give me the color code.
Yeah, well, I'm sure that we have some Rivian folks watching. Comment with the color code.
Yep. And here we're doing orange.
Yeah, I think if we're going to go orange on our truck, which might be kind of cool, I think I might have the calipers and the other thing to match it as well.
Good.
I think it's, I don't know if orange and yellow go that well together. That's what Alyssa and I were talking about.
Yeah, I think it's going to be, if you're going to go, you got to go all into it. Now, people have gray and people like the orange because it goes a good accent.
Yeah, I was thinking gray and orange would be a good thing.
It also looks good. It's the red. It brings the taillights. And it's amazing when colors draw out other colors when they're near each other, right?
Yeah.
So, depending on the type of vehicle, the safe bet is black or red, typically.
Sure.
Because of trim, right? Yep. And tires and or taillights, right? Because it's quality. You need it. They come in two different sizes. They have a little bit smaller version that we use as well. But it's a gateway to other things that they offer, from shovels to fair leads. A lot of cool stuff that they have. And again, I couldn't have more respect and I'm happily to be a distributor to these guys.
So Agency 6.
Agency 6.
I'll leave their website in the description for our viewers if they want to check out any of their accessories.
As well.
And again, everything for this truck, you know, my whole theme is it's going to get beat up. We are going to not be easy to it. It's got to last. And so, it's all good.
On this one here, we used to have these slots that are 3/8 of an inch on the top all the way around, and we're putting grab handles. So technically, this is kind of sloppy in there and it would sometimes be crooked.
Sure.
We found the only thing we're putting on the side here is grab handles. So what did we do? We made it smaller and specific for grab handles.
Oh, that's awesome.
What that allows you now to do is micro adjust to wherever you want it. Here, stop, up here, and tighten it down. Or you can have it all the way down here. This is the happy height right about here because when we raise the vehicle, it's right about this height so you can grab on it.
Right, because right now we're aired all the way out. Yeah.
When the truck goes up, this will be your best friend. Right?
That's awesome.
So we're going to be putting these all the way across here. And then take a look. They've already got the lights on. Look at this.
Yep. No, that's awesome. And these will light up in sort of a bronzy color.
Yes.
When
and the bronze is a bronze, like a real nice amber.
It's a deep running light color.
Absolutely. What I don't like personally is I don't like the yellow.
Yeah, I agree. So the wiring is coming right out of here. Now, we're going to have to wire this all up when we get back to Colorado we're going to have to choose a controller. Alyssa, what are you thinking? What controller is your preference?
I'm thinking about Garmin.
Yeah, thinking about Garmin, absolutely. But Sam, you said that should work pretty well for us.
I think so, because from what I understand, it's a controller too, right?
Yep.
So.
And we can control it from our phone, which is nice. So Bluetooth in.
What we see in the overlanding spot is that people like the Switch Pro because it's easy.
Right. The Switch Pro seems to be the popular. That's what the Rivians were using for build. But it really doesn't matter. You hook it up to anything with power.
Absolutely. What I like about them is giving you three LEDs in there, Switch Pro or S-Pod. Predominantly Switch Pro we put mostly in. I like them because they're easy. They're bulletproof.
Yeah.
They work really well.
And we might end up going Switch Pro. We'll see. Yeah.
You press the button and you enable the dimming output, and it's got three levels. High, the 50%, and then down either 5 or 15, I think it is. And you could actually use them as running lights. Well, I'm in the rain in the mountains. I'm using these as running lights.
Yeah, and I think that must just look amazing going down the road.
It looks insane. It really looks cool. And then what it does, it just lets people see you in the desert, leave them bright.
So yeah.
They can see them as true. They can see you from the side.
Yeah, totally.
The thing why we came up with this, it was a two-pronged deal. When your rock lights are typically meant for the spotter underneath here.
Right,
when you're crawling, right? But what about the driver? When you're by yourself, you're on a trail. Guess what lights up?
Right, yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah.
the cool thing about this is, for me, the Rivian, so the, have you played around with an F-150, a new one at all?
How about the Raptor R?
Yeah, Raptor R. But you know how they have like that camp lighting feature?
Yeah.
Where they light up everything around you? Yeah. This is such a cool truck and it's so built, but there's
the same
you
thing.
Can't see a dang thing outside of it. So now we can actually see where we're going
to
be.
You show up to camp and then we'll, on the roof rack, which we've got, and this kind of goes with the lighting aspect of it, is that we have these down brackets. So on the roof rack here,
yep.
Let's imagine we have this cool rack on here. We have this pointed here. That rock light is now pointed down.
Right.
And you put that on a separate switch and you have it on the left and right. You might as well if you have the switches, right?
Yep.
I can now light up around my campsite, whether I'm going to hit a boulder, trip over a rock or a bench.
Totally.
You can set up camp until you get your regular lighting set up without, you know.
Yep.
It's controlled by your phone as well. So these are the accessories and the bolt-ons that we're talking from a base level. You'll have a real solid foundation to start with, right?
That's awesome.
And that's what this rack's about.
I mean, already, just look at how cool the truck is looking right now. It's just awesome. Alyssa the builder over here.
Take a look at this. There's mouse holes in there too as well. You see that?
Oh yeah, down in here. Okay. Yep, I do.
Take that and put that in the center.
And when we remove the rack, we don't have to undo any of these top bits. We can just remove the bottom.
Absolutely.
And pull this all off as one assembled piece.
There's a logo on that. Look at the back over here. We haven't said anything. Where do you think that goes?
Do.
Yeah. Look in the center. You were there. There you go. Slides over. There you go.
Sick.
The reason was that at some point, without instructions, I've had people put it together without instructions. They didn't look at them. They just want to dive in.
Sure.
You can almost, it almost makes sense where it goes.
That's cool.
Right?
Yeah, they are. So this goes right there. Now that's our spine. Okay.
Yep.
So that's kind of the foundation of our rack. So when we're installing, all right, Jake, you ready?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's going to be fine. Okay. So what we do first is we get this pulled out and we put a couple bolts in here. Yeah, just kind of morphed.
Yep. No, that's so cool. And the height is almost perfect with the roof of the truck.
We've also got a provision to get the tent over the cab as well.
Yes.
Is that we have our risers.
And that's what we're going to do with our tent, is raise it up.
So we have a 2-inch and a 4-inch riser.
Yeah, what do you recommend for the Rivian? A 2-inch?
2-inch is sufficient, I think.
Yeah.
Maybe, well, it really depends, though, because it really depends on how large the tent is, how far you got to go forward.
Okay.
So check these out.
Right, because if you need to clear something, you got to go pretty high.
4-inch steel, we don't mess around when it comes to extensions.
That's freaking gnarly. 4-inch
steel.
Double washers?
Okay, right there, they're in that bag.
And those double washers?
Yes. Inside and outside. So we typically go like this here.
I think we should do the 2-inch. That will work well with the iCamper, right? Which that's really the size of tent that we're going to go.
And you have to stop here anyway, so it gets you to the point where you need to get. Are you doing 3.0 mini?
That's what we're leaning towards. We're going to test fit a few different ones from some Colorado companies, do some videos on the Overlanding channel.
The 3.0 mini works perfect with this. It stops you right about here. It gives you good balance. What we do, stainless steel, welded. We even cut our own washers. What this slides into the channel, I'll leave you with these to take back with you.
Okay.
You slide them in to the channel of the iCamper. It drops down into,
and this is for like the iCamper to mount to a typical cross rail.
It would come out through there, and look at there.
So plenty of room to get in there.
Room, you put a wrench in there, you get a ratcheting 9/16.
Okay, sick.
Now, what it also allows you to do, see how this can move over?
Yeah.
So wherever that extrusion comes, if you get a shot up here,
yeah,
look at the slots there.
Yeah, oh, nice.
We have slots for zip tying wires.
Yeah.
We'll talk about the wiring. But more importantly is that you could slide this and micro-adjust this exactly where it needs to go.
Right, just so everything's perfectly level and straight.
So that's why we never tighten everything up until you get ready to really start forming things with, like the rack. You don't ever tighten this up either. Let it loose on the tent. And once you get the tent centered and you move things around, what I do is I measure the extrusion to center point. And then I kind of put them in that with the rack, right? Then I set the tent on top, and then at that point, then you get your baseline where you want to be. So you put the bolts where they need to go. And at that point, now you could decide.
So sick.
Because then
you could do an offset tent if you wanted to with an awning out the other side or something like that. So
I don't have the, we can look on my truck.
but I have some coming into stock here next week. This is our awning bracket, and we have a chamfer that's built in here. It's specifically meant for the iCamper, and I'll tell you what happened. So when the iCamper opens up on clamshell, kind of like this here.
Yeah.
We have that chamfer. You have to move it far enough away to where it opens up.
Mm-hmm.
It just matches the chamfer that goes here.
So it's really like if you go for this bed rack, the iCamper 3.0 Mini on top, that's like the perfect Rivian setup.
The size,
dynamic. And then you can do the tent, or sorry, the awning off the side. And
this is 3/16. Our awning bracket's made out of quarter inch steel. I want you to look at my truck before we go. Get a shot of it, include it in this video.
Yeah.
Because it's quarter inch steel, this is gusseted to here. You can extend, and this goes out further, 9 inches.
Yeah.
You can extend that awning bracket out almost 3 inches here, right? And it will not budge.
That's awesome.
But that gives you the room to recenter your tent.
Right.
Even when you open it, like.
So right, because no one ever gets a centered tent with an awning.
Yeah, this is not going to be totally centered either because of just how short this is, the width of it.
Okay. I mean,
but it sure gets a lot closer. Right?
Nice.
And again, quarter inch steel, right?
So awesome. Nice work, Alyssa. Appreciate you building my truck.
Yeah.
Man, look at just how sick this looks down the side.
I have this molly panel here.
Yep.
I'll have a plate here, and the plate's going to drop down, and it's going to level out. It's going to stop here.
Yep.
So we can bolt something to it, right? I have a shovel here still.
Sure.
Undo the preload, lock it down. Now it's a shelf.
Right.
It's going to sit there.
That's cool. Yeah.
It'll sit on here. Yep. You run your exhaust tubes, run to your power.
And right. We got the power right in the bed of this thing anyway. So that's perfect. Yeah.
See, so that's the accessories, you know, to the dress, so to speak.
Right? I like that. That's really cool. And this is the one time put together. Again, when we want to remove it, it's just these, this, and boom, the thing's off. The wiring for the lights is going to be.
It's actually not that difficult.
But how do we make it so that it's removable?
Okay, so it's removable here. You take one switch. So I'm making harnesses to where it goes over here, it goes down the spine, spines out, right?
Right.
You end up with a whip of 10 feet.
Okay.
On that whip of 10 feet, you put a plug. You put a Molex or...
connector.
And lift it.
Oh, that's what we need. That's sick. Are we going to have that?
I'll set you up.
You got to set me up. Okay,
so
good.
Check this out. See the mouse hole here?
Yep.
That runs down the spine, and they run down here, and you zip tie all your lines to the top.
Oh, that's sick.
You see, it drips down to here, and you put a Molex on here, and a Molex there.
Super
if you
pro.
You want to take it apart.
Yes.
If you want to take it apart, you undo the Molex, leave the spine in there. When you put it back together, here, click it.
And then it's just everything snaps together.
Snaps back together.
Dude, so pro. You know what's funny, Alyssa? Actually, I was just thinking about this. You know how like all of our small characters on YouTube, like Colton's just completely obsessive and crazy, and Drew's Mr. Performance Driver. You're like Mr. Overland to the max.
Well, I think that again, if we're gonna beat up our stuff, and let's face it, Alyssa, you do me a favor. Hold this in place. I'm gonna slide down, put a nut on there with the washer. There we go. I put 4 bolts on here instead of 2. 1, 2, and I have a third one. If you shift it down, you can use the metal.
Yep.
More position down here. I figured that if you're going to beat the crap out of our stuff, it needs to hold up to it. So if one fails, you have 3 other. Because I've had
that's awesome.
I had a couple come loose.
Yeah.
And I heard a rattling when I grabbed it. I go, what the hell? And I hit the rack. If you hear the rattle, you can find which one
yeah.
loose. And one had come loose, and then you heard the washer going. But I had 3 others that were still. There.
Nice. So maybe a good idea to like maybe every year or two just tighten up the rack.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And even in between, I mean, as hard as we are on these trucks, it would not hurt you to probably just check things every other 2-3 trips.
Yeah, sure.
But these have Nylock on them, so you don't need Loctite.
Mm-hmm.
Nylock does its job. If you take apart this molly panel, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 times, the Nylock's going to wear out.
Right. It's a new hardware if you're doing a lot of that.
Do that. So,
but there's really no need from my perspective, especially as the whole thing comes out as one piece, which is the most attractive bit to me that it locks to this. That's awesome. I mean, it's just fun to see these companies grow, especially in new spaces like electric. Overlanding is still a relatively new space in automotive and really gaining popularity. I'd say almost more popular than traditional racing at this point. But man, the truck's looking good. We've panned over and now the molly panels are in, looking so great with that contrast. Personally, I love that look. I know some of our viewers will definitely want to go blacked out, but just increases the usability massively. Put the iCamper on top or a tent similar with that mounting bracket and the risers. We'll have the lights down the side. We're going to go up into the roof rack,
but we'll take a quick pause, get this all finished up. Yeah, the orange is probably good for YouTube, but I think if we were building the truck, maybe not to pop so much on camera, I think I would go.
So
yeah. So the bronze, I think black is the move. I think that's what people are going to do.
So the other consideration too, I love seeing the craftsmanship here and seeing the rib nuts.
Yes.
We also are consider doing black ones as well.
Okay.
And what we're going to do is we're still, the jury's out whether we're going to set the molly panels. We're going to put the holes in regardless. They can come with or without the rib nuts. We'll sell the rib nuts in a kit, or we can do the rib nuts for the client. Depends on what they want. We're just kind of up in the air. We want to see what the trend is. And if the trend is that everybody wants them, we're just going to put them in and call it a day. And,
yeah, I think that's going to be the trend. People want it easy. I mean, ultimately, you'll find the few guys who want to do a custom solution, but 99% of people just want to buy it and install stuff. All right, well, now the rack is installed, totally bolted down, super freaking pro. Can yank on this thing all day long. Yeah, Sam will do the demonstration. So awesome. No deflection anywhere. And we're going to go for a little drive. We're going to get some lunch, get some high quality McDonald's, and the tonneau should work still. So let's see. I have the only functioning tonneau left in existence somehow. Rivian's like, just keep doing whatever you're doing to keep it alive, which is, I kind of use it often. Sometimes I help it out a little bit, but there we go. Tonneau closed with the rack. Super sick. This just completes the look of the Rivian. Honestly, yeah, I'm kind of thinking maybe we should have done black here, but now once we get the orange up there, I think it'll all blend in. Got the orange watch thing going. I don't know. Orange is an out of spec color. So when we come up with the wrap idea for this, we're going to incorporate orange, but it does look a little bit weird having orange with yellow.
What's yellow?
The brake calipers.
Oh, that's why people want to match.
That's why we were saying that.
We were trying to match the Rivian yellow, like truck yellow.
That is this yellow.
Ew, it's the same?
Yeah. Yeah. So we'll go for a little shakedown run, just see how it does. Tonneau works. Everything works. Got all my access buttons for the gear tunnel. Man, just crazy installation. Everything super bolted down. Hardcore metal. No rattles. Just next level. Well, we are out for a drive and actually out for lunch. Where did we go?
We went to Flame Broiler.
Flame Broiler. It was actually awesome.
Great meal. Say that fast three times.
And it was at a charging station, so we juiced up the truck. We're at 71% now. And so that was good that we killed two birds with one stone. We got juice, the car got juice, or we got food, the car got juice. But we're out testing out the rack on the truck, and I've just been kind of driving it around and literally hear nothing. No wind noise. We were just doing 55 miles an hour. Zero change. Now, I imagine it's going to be a little bit louder wind noise with the light bar up here. What do you think?
You're going to be surprised.
You think it'll still be quiet?
You'll be surprised.
All right. We'll definitely test that. But if you look behind you, there's no visibility change out the back from my viewpoint. So like you guys in that shot can see the top of the rack. Where my eyes are looking in the rearview mirror, cannot see the top of the rack at all. It looks unchanged out the back. I can see the inside molly panels on the side. That's why it kind of gives me this SUV look back there, but very, very little impact. Zero impact of visibility. That's huge, especially as we put the rooftop tent on top. Really not going to get in the way. Absolutely love that. And the truck just looks cool. We walked up to the charger. We were like, oh, damn, this completes
changes the look. It toughens it up a little bit, right? And just gives it a mean look.
Totally. And I even think, like, if you're going to choose, like, I'm sure a lot of people will probably just go in and buy the full system, do the roof and the bed at the same time. But I think if you had to choose one, I think the bed rack is so cool. What do you think?
It gives you an SUV feel. It gives you a lot of capability. Now with the new molly panels, with the rib nuts, you can put all your gear on top. It's out of the way. Reserve all of the room you can for your truck bed. One thing that you don't notice as well is when you do the wiring for the lights, because we have the mouse holes at the top and slots on top, you can run all your wiring, different wires for different things, plugs for, you know, into your jackery, into a solar panel.
Yep.
You can hide them. You don't see any wires either.
Yeah.
No. Even through the back, you just see your constant, whatever that frame is, and that's it.
So awesome. And once we get the DCE sliders on here,
than the Martian wheels. This thing's going to all come together. Yeah. I just want a metal bumper, which I know is going to be a pain.
It's going to be a tough. That's going to be the tough one.
Yeah.
It will.
But someone will figure it out someday. And then we'll have a nice range metal bumpers. And they can't be these big, ugly bumpers. It's got to be a classy, good-looking front end.
It's got to be.
So that's the next thing. But I guess we're heading back to the shop now. Yeah. We're juiced up. I can hear the AC compressor again trying to cool down the battery pack. And we are going to install the roof.
Yep.
Now, what is it? What's actually going to look like when we look up?
Well, all you'll see, you'll see three crossbars going across. It's 1x3 extrusions on there.
Yeah.
You will actually see that.
Cool.
Going across, you
see.
But
we'll still see daylight out
there. Oh, absolutely.
It's on a full plate. Yeah.
You're making left that lights you up.
Okay. Cool.
Well, I had a user that we put on a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. He called me up and said, "Sam, it actually helped me out to have a little bit of shade because it gets pretty hot with this thing here."
Yes.
Told.
Yeah, it does.
And he has now just put on his cases on top. And he said, "Sam, I'm good to see outside. I can still see my little bits and pieces of it, but it's a lot cooler inside here now because I got some coverage."
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, let's go walk through the process of installing that, but so far just thrilled with that bed rack. That is that's the answer to all of the stuff I wanted on this
truck. You know what's cool about the roof rack too as well is that we build the rack separately. We build it on a rollaway deal. Hmm. We actually assemble the lights, put on the handles, flip it over, put on the light bar, have it all in one piece.
And then just drop it.
And just drop it into place, lock it down, and we're done. So it's a pretty simple process, should go pretty smooth.
Can't wait to see it. Let's go build this thing.
Cool. I'm in.
Well, that's
thanks
great.
For coming back here for the roof rack. And we're just going to walk through the components.
Yeah.
This is more of what's underneath the hood. We have our modular system, our side panels here. We got a bracket that's going to connect the two together. We're actually starting to walk through that process right
now. So this is what we're going to see vertical when we look down the side of the truck.
Absolutely.
Up here.
What blocks onto here, your grab handles, side brackets, lights, extrusion, modular. We have a cutout here. This is to access the light bar when you're tightening things in.
Oh, nice.
You actually have an access port. And with our traditional 45 cuts, that match what we do. Just a small detail.
And the light bar, did we have to adapt this specifically for the rigid light bar at all?
Yes, we did. So that's funny. Alyssa, parts manager.
Yes, sir.
Can you grab that light, please?
Yep.
Don't drop it. That thing is, that is no joke, that light bar.
The E-DAPT.
That light bar is almost as much as the roof rack.
Yeah.
That thing is legit.
I think it's probably, I think
it might be more.
And this has all the adaptive technology wrapped into this with battery efficient technology. Rigid, I hope I didn't butcher that, but it's got battery efficiency technology.
If you did, Rigid, comment below.
Driving conditions happen, changes. We'll do some B-roll for you on that as well. That goes on there. So I'm going to show you the adjustment. Let me come over here real quick. I'm going to grab a bracket here. So on the stealth system.
By the way, Sam, you have a YouTube channel as well, which we'll leave in the description. Yeah. You got a way nicer setup than we do.
And we rolled up and we were like, oh, we're going to so disappoint this guy as we just pull out our iPhone. Say, okay.
So another interesting thing too is when you buy the rack, because it's modular, it's in a bunch of different pieces, right? You start out with no light bar. You say, I don't want to touch electrical until it's all figured out, right? So this now becomes a full fascia, right? And I have that available now. If you choose to go to the light bar situation later, the only thing you have to purchase is the new fascia, the brackets, and that's it.
So it's just a literally unscrew, new brackets, light bar on.
You probably will have to take the rack off. It's, again, it's 8 bolts, lift it off, flip the rack over, put these in place. Because there's a quarter round of extrusion that goes on this piece that you've got to reach and get a nut in there.
I see.
Turn it upside down, put on the light bar, flip it back over, drop it on, you're ready to go. And the best part about that is you retain your investment of all the other pieces. The extrusion, the side panels, the brackets.
Yeah, you don't need a whole new rack.
The cool brackets that we almost lost.
Yeah, that's right. Alyssa's brackets.
What is this called? That's going to be the Alyssa bracket.
Yeah.
The new SKU. AL911 is the new SKU.
Birthday,
so yeah, that's true. Yes, it is.
There you go. And then, of course, then we have the multi-purpose connection pieces that come along with it as well. Same technology as we did the bed rack right over. Comes with hardware kits just like this here. Has everything you need. There's a separate hardware kit for the quarter rounds. We have these here as well for the rock lights. And then we have what's included, breaking the case of emergency.
It comes with a couple extra of each one of the bolts. If you run out or need more, you'll have that as well. So what we're going to do, oh, last piece. There's a separation here, guys. What I do, one by one or one by two is what a lot of people use. It's the lightweight extrusion. Hold that. That's pretty decent heavy, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, that's
heavy. Yeah, it's lighter than that, but it's certainly strong. It's a heavy-duty 1x3 extrusion. I can remember once that rack's on there, I could stand there and jump on it. It's not going to budge.
Wow.
Again, if we're going off-roading, right, you're going to have, you have an event. You want this thing to be able to strong enough to spread the load all the way across. There's another thing. We have now, there's other manufacturers that take this side panel, and where we have these holes here, the Alyssa 911 bracket here is attached here. And this is what's attached to the connection points. So the rationale behind that is extrusion is aluminum is extruded on the down, which is the long. If you put a bend in it, naturally and inherently, it's going to have stress fractures in it. If you have a fracture in there and it becomes weak and you have 200 pounds up on your rack and it does that.
Yeah, not good.
It breaks. Because they're also on risers and on one bolt. On one bolt, sometimes two. So now you've only got that little bit, and all the pressure goes, and it snaps. Now you have a roof rack that's rattling for the rest of your trip and potentially ruin the top of your rack. You're going to have to break steel. This is steel, not aluminum. This is aluminum, this is steel. So steel's attached to the aluminum, powder-coated right there. And that's what goes on there like that. So now you're going to have to bend and break steel. And chances are it's not going to happen. You'll probably rip the truck apart before that happens. So that's not going to break. So it gives us additional strength.
Super cool.
So that's all the pieces that we have for this right now. We're going to go ahead and start doing assembly.
Yeah.
And I will be back when it's kind of all put together.
Right. So we'll basically assemble the rack off board, get everything mounted. And then once it's time, we're just going to drop it on the Rivian. Sam, this thing is looking good, sir.
Well, thank you. Yeah, we just put on the light bar, and we've got adjustability right here for level now. It's level now, right?
Yeah, yeah.
We've got our brackets in here tied down with the T-nuts. We use the factory connection points. There's a plastic insert. We changed to our black oxide stainless steel bolts. Their zinc bolts are there, but we just like to finish this off to make sure everything matches.
Yep.
And we got the bolt. We got our cord running here.
Right, that's how we can hook up the light bar wiring.
We're going to zip tie these for now.
Yep.
Before it's done. Light bar's installed. We're going to basically go ahead and put this on the rack. There's one more element. There's a noise suppressor that I'm going to put on here.
Okay.
I'm going to pop rip it, the logo's on, and we're ready to go.
Then we're rocking. Yeah. Dude, that's awesome.
So what I'm doing here, I'm kind of walking this, and this is not fully installed yet.
Yep, you're just getting it placed.
Yeah, it's getting placed, and I want to get the distance right for my final cut. Again, just tap that on. And there it goes, kind of just goes with it all the way. And I know that there's my cut line. So what I do now, hand me my tool behind you right there, if you would.
Yep.
Without cutting my finger off. There. There. Straight cut. And just form it. There's a little kick up there. And just make sure you get all edges covered about 2 inches apart. And in place. There it is, a conforming. There you have it.
Now it just looks super pro. Really looking nice right there. That's a cool, cool piece you got. All right, so we've got all the wires zip tied in over here just as a placeholder until we can get it all wired up. When we get back to Colorado, we got to pick, you know, what kind of control system we're going to do. All that stuff will come later on, but for now, the hardware is there. So it's time to basically install the roof rack. We're going to get it right sided first so it looks super pro this way.
Here we go. So that's the light rack. Let's walk around it, pal.
Yep.
Take a look.
Make sure everything looks good.
Bolts
tightened up. Hey guys, so one of the things that we struggle with is finding hardware that is appropriate to our level, what we're looking for. These are made overseas. We have no control over it. But what's happened is that they have a poor zinc or nickel coating on them. We're going to think of a new solution that made out of aluminum. But what this is doing, it's a liquid powder coat. It seeps down into the threads. It covers it up, and it's kind of a rust preventative at this point.
And it's a great way to keep everything fully black as well.
Exactly.
That way we don't have this odd color.
This is from Cardinal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's called Paint and Powder. It's called, and you can get it directly from them. But once you put it on here, it seeps itself into the threads.
And what that's going to do, it's going to create a little bit of a barrier. And I go a little heavy with it because I want it to soak in there. And if you see in a minute, we'll go back to the other one. There we go. Look at that, how it's already sunk down onto the threads in there. Creates kind of cool little barrier.
Yeah,
barrier,
totally.
Keeps things blacked out. And we'll do all these across the top before we put them on.
Yep. All right, time to get the rack up. I got the truck aired out. Yeah. Alyssa's muscle man over here. We got the blanket on the roof so it doesn't scratch anything.
Good. Cool. So now what we
want to
do here is I'm
going to lift. Oh, dang. That is looking cool up there. Well, holy smokes, guys. It's been a full day of installation. Super long video. Hopefully, if you're interested in the rack, it helps you, choose a rack. At least you've learned more about this particular one. I like it because it's super well suited to the Rivian and built really well, but at least goes to show you maybe what you should look for in a rack if you're shopping around. Also just took it for a drive, a little shakedown. Really awesome. There is, the one thing I was really worried about is, were we going to have a ton of wind noise? And the answer is no. It's not quieter though. Of course you can hear it, especially, once you get north of 55, 60, 70 miles an hour, there's no whistle, which is great. If there was a whistle, I would rip this thing off immediately. Zero whistle, but it does kind of sound like you're driving into a headwind a little bit. And that's to be expected. We put a massive light bar on there, just turn up the music a little bit. It really isn't bad. It's not, the truck has some wind noise out of the factory anyway, so it's, just a few decibels louder. I'd say I'm very impressed considering all the stuff we put on here. But just the solidity, the installation process, it was great to do it with Sam, know exactly what needs to get done. He's got a little tricks with the little paint powder coating situation on all the bolts. He's such a perfectionist, so this truck is just money right now. Let me just take you on a quick tour. I know it's dark outside, but just so you can see the whole thing, we parked it next to Sam's truck. These are the same lights we put on ours, just so you can get an idea of the color. And so just lighting up the side of this thing, you can see we got the rigid light bar, we got the whole panels here, super awesome hardware everywhere. We got the down lights, which look great. And then coming into the back, just super pro, super flush with the top. We got the bed rack, the inside Molly panels, the outside panels. And then we got this guy warming up the planet next to us. just so freaking cool. The tonneau cover still works. Everything seems super factory. This is how I would do it. I think we can mount a rooftop tent right up here. We got the risers for it, everything. I couldn't be happier. Alyssa, your thoughts?
I love it. Had so much fun today. And
Not a sponsored video. We just love it.
And I'm excited to see what else is to come for it.
Yeah, I mean, this is a great starting point. So glad we chose this system. Maybe tomorrow I'll feel different. I don't know, see why. It's just freaking perfect.
I agree.
Built for the truck.
Yeah.
Well, let's go to bed.
Let's go to bed.
I'm so tired.
Bye, guys.